I'd like to see if you know or remember these TV characters. When we get them up here. Here they are. Jim Halpert from The Office, you know him? George Jetson, do you remember him? Ted Mosby from the show How I Met Your Mother. Now, these three actually have something in common. According to the online encyclopedia Wikipedia, they are examples of a literary device known as everyman. An everyman is an ordinary man, someone that we can most relate to when we experience a story. And sometimes to an everyman, even though he's ordinary, extraordinary things can happen. And when a story begins to unfold, it's often the case that you don't notice the everyman in the story. He's a secondary character, not fully developed. Yet an everyman is the character that we usually most identify with. We see ourselves in that character in the story. And would we really want to have stories without folks like Jim and George and Ted, who connect us to the story, who help us relate? Oftentimes, the everyman is the unsung hero. I did not take the opportunity to look and see if there are examples of an every woman in the same way. I'm sure there are, because I wanted to move us quickly this morning into a story of who I think is the most important everyman ever to have lived. From the Gospel according to Matthew today, we hear about Joseph, the earthly father of Jesus, engaged to Mary. Joseph is in many ways an ordinary man, and in the stories of Jesus' birth and Jesus' life that we have recorded for us, Joseph never says a word. He's often overshadowed by the others, particularly Mary, his wife, and of course, Jesus. But the decisions that Joseph makes and the way that he acts upon his decisions make his role vital in God's plan of salvation, in God's plan of coming into the world through his son, Jesus Christ. Joseph was common in many ways, like the others. He lived in the small town with his fellow citizens of Nazareth. He lived a humble, quiet life. He was a carpenter. Most likely, he was poor. And he was engaged to a young virgin named Mary. And you know the story, I believe, that before they can complete their marriage, Mary is pregnant. And Joseph knows that the child is not his. Now, Joseph has some choices here. He could take Mary out into the town square and have her stoned for adultery. He could make a scene, and he could bring her to shame. But Matthew's gospel also tells us that Joseph is a righteous man. He doesn't want to disgrace her publicly. But it is with a broken heart that Joseph decides that he's going to annul the marriage as quickly and quietly as possible. This is a great act of mercy And in his day, it is more than would have been expected. When he makes this decision, an angel comes to Joseph in a dream and tells him to not be afraid to take Mary as his wife, because the child is conceived by the Holy Spirit. Joseph is to adopt Mary's son. Joseph is to complete the marriage. And then Joseph is to name the child Jesus, a name which suggests what Jesus will do. He will save God's people from their sins. And it would have been much easier for Joseph to ignore the dream and to go on with his life as best as he could in that moment. He could have stepped away from the gossip and the innuendos, from the shame and the shunning that inevitably would take place. No matter what he decided, his life was never going to be the same. And then we are told that Joseph does everything that the angel commands him to do. He marries Mary. He takes Jesus as his own child, and he names him Jesus. And you know, when we hear this story, we realize and recognize that Joseph, in obeying God, was going to have to let go of his old life so that he could make room for God's possibilities and God's future to play themselves out in his. He knew that his life would change forever. Joseph, in this moment, is a common man caught up in the cosmic affairs of God's plan of salvation. And what else is interesting about Joseph is that we really don't know that much about him, even as he played this role as the father of Jesus. There's another story about him which we'll hear the first Sunday of Christmas, January 31st and December 31st and January 1st. There are a couple of mentions of him, but really, he disappears from the story. By the time Jesus begins his ministry, there's no mention of Joseph, and biblical scholars suggest that he has already died. It is as if Joseph plays his part and quietly exits the stage so that others could carry on the story and allow it to unfold. When the angel says to Joseph, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." And when he does everything that the angel commands him to do, Joseph is opening himself up to the power and the presence of God in his life and in the world. And I think when we hear this story at this time of year about Mary and Joseph and their role in God's plan of salvation, we tend to elevate them a bit. We admire them for their great faithfulness. We admire them for the role that they played. And maybe in elevating them a bit, it makes us feel a little better, knowing and believing that God couldn't possibly work through an ordinary person like you and like me and every man and every woman. But don't we also know, at a profound level, that God does not or did not just call the saints of old, but God calls all people to hear God's voice and to respond in faith. when God speaks, to listen and to live our lives open to what God has in store for us. 4 years ago this weekend, together as a congregation with Pastor Haley Vey, we discerned together that you would be called to be our pastor. And now, this weekend and this moment, we can't help but to reflect in gratitude for what we have done together in service of Christ and one another, for the ways that we've lived and loved and served together. God spoke to us in that moment, and we listened by coming together as pastor and people. And now God's speaking again. God is speaking again, calling Haley Vey to a new place and into a new moment, and is calling us as well to be the church in a new way. And so we move forward into this moment with joy and excitement, but also with tears and fears, trusting that wherever we are being led, God will faithfully lead us as we follow. Thank you, Haley Vey, for responding to God's call and for this time among us, the way that you lived so fully and faithfully into your call as our pastor. And God continues to speak. As people of faith, our life is about listening to what God has to say to us. And so I would like for you to repeat these words after me. I am loved. I am precious.
I am precious.
I am called.
I am called.
Now, you may not always see yourself in these ways. It's hard for us sometimes to see ourselves as God sees us. And if you start to think and believe that God cannot and does not call an every man, every woman like yourself, would you please do yourself a favor and remember the story of Joseph today? Because when Joseph opened himself up to what God said to him, his life changed and the world changed. And it's when we open ourselves up to God that transformation, real transformation, takes place in our lives and in our world. New life, new possibilities, new birth. And at this time of year, we rejoice in the ways that the possibilities and promises of God live themselves out and call us into a future with joy and with hope. Let us always live our lives open and faithful to the glory of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.